This morning, it's my pleasure to introduce today's speaker, and the platform topic today is staying connected across the political divide with leader Randy Best. This is a well-timed topic for me. My parents were recently fully vaccinated, and I will be fully vaccinated soon. And so we're planning to meet for the first time in over a year. It's been over a year since I've seen my mom and dad. And while I'm excited, I also know that our political opinions and leanings are quite different. And so it's always challenging, even in the best of times, to see them because oftentimes political conversations happen and are challenging to navigate because, of course, they're my parents and I love them more than anything. But I also wholeheartedly disagree with them on many things. So I'm really excited about this topic and want to tell you a little bit about Randy Best. He's been a lifelong member of Ethical Culture. Born in St. Louis, Randy grew up attending the St. Louis Ethical Society, where his mother is still an active member. Since 2016, Randy has served as the leader of the Northern Virginia Ethical Society. He is also Dean of Leader Training for the American Ethical Union. Previously, he was leader of Ethical Humanist Society of the Triangle and the Ethical Society Without Walls. Randy received a BA from Grinnell College and a master's degree from Harvard University. He is a graduate of the Humanist Institute, a certified mediator, and pastoral counselor. Randy divides his time between Northern Virginia and Durham, North Carolina, where he lives with his wife, Sarah Howe, a ceramic artist. They have four grown children whom they homeschooled. And with that, I will turn it over to Randy Best. Thank you so much for being here with us today.
Thank you. Thank you for that great introduction. It's always a pleasure to speak at the New York Society for Ethical Culture, and this is an interesting hybrid environment to be speaking in, but I think it shows that we are on the cutting edge of making accommodations with the pandemic and moving forward. My talk this morning is staying connected across the political divide. Our political environment lays bare the increasing polarization in American society. Red, blue, liberal, conservative, wingnut, libtard, Trump, not Trump. Our political discourse in our thinking creates an us versus them dichotomy, and such divisions are referred to as othering. Long-standing political issues remain largely unchanged, while our identities themselves have hardened into uncompromising opposition. These self-claimed identities are increasingly tied to our politics. This is not a good thing. Many view those on the other side of the political divide as a threat to our nation and our own well-being. A political environment of fear and hostility creates an existential crisis for many Americans, where the perceived solution is asserting political and cultural dominance. Perceived stakes ratchet up to a level of us or them, all or nothing, patriotic glory or cultural dissolution, a cascade of othering. How did we get here? There are many reasons for our present predicament. Among them, changes in our media consumption is the most significant factor. The rise of one-sided media consumption contributes to our increasingly polarized society. A multiplicity of media channels and information sources lead us to experience increasingly siloed viewpoints, information tailored to self-reinforcing information loops. Our phones and our computers are watching us, recording what we look at, feeding us information based on what we read and search and what we like, and are also on what our contacts read, search, and like as well. Recently, I shopped online for a bidet, and now I am forever haunted by toilet appliance advertisements. popping up on my social media whenever I'm there. There is no escape. I am stuck in a self-reinforcing information loop where I only see things that reflect my opinions, where I am pushed toward the ever-increasing extremes of my thought. It is increasingly hard to vet the information stream washing over me. When I don't stop, take a breath, flip on my skepticism switch, and take time to verify, I open myself to misinformation. The problem is that it feels good to see my worst suspicions verified. I feel knowledgeable, sometimes righteous. It's hard to put on the brakes. The information flows and flows, and so much of it is false and misleading. Yeah, I guess I blame Facebook and Twitter, mostly Twitter. And of course, I blame myself. Tristan Harris, co-founder of the Center for Humane Technology, who was featured in the documentary The Social Dilemma, addressed this problem in a recent interview. He spoke about the difficulty of moderating content. Who decides which posts incite violence? He observed that the American psyche has been split into right and left, or as I see it, extreme right and center left. The brain of our country is split in two and can't agree, fed by different content streams where a shared view of reality has slipped away. We have become a cyborg democracy. Our brain's cyborg implants are the streams of media and social media that we consume. As a nation, our cyborg democracy has driven us a bit crazy. Social media thrives on pushing buttons. Everything from cute cat memes to the zombie pedophile apocalypse. Fear propagates on social media faster than compassion. Misinformation, disinformation thrives. Social media is designed this way, without safeguards to prevent lies from being shared again and again. Controlling this ocean of electronic information, dangerous lies and deception, is something new for humanity. How do I sift through this quagmire when the scale of media postings exceeds the capacity of resources dedicated to monitoring and regulating the flow? The only solution being implemented right now is turning off accounts after they incite violence. This blunt tool is implemented long after the damage has already been done. The flow of social media is incessant, contradictory, and confusing. Cat memes aside, much of it is overlaid on a background of an uncertain world of chaos and perceived danger. Navigating this space is difficult, and it's too easy to move in small steps into a distorted view of reality. It is challenging to make sense of a scary and uncertain world. I try to piece together a map of the world that makes sense. My very act of thinking involves mapping my world, seeing how things fit together, selecting relevant causal actions and results. At January's All Society platform, Replacing Magical Thinking with Rational Discourse, the three panelists, Joan Johnson Lewis, Christian Hayden, and David Spritzen, reflected on the nature of human thought. They presented the difference between magical thinking and evidence thinking. Evidence thinking, based on established facts and using reason. Magical thinking, grounded in mystery, intuition, and uncanny connections. Magical thinking leaves you free to establish your own facts and to weave your own reality. Magical thinking is emotionally satisfying, not critically assessed, unbounded by factual evidence. It is a method of making sense of the world, of pr- providing explanations for what we see in the world and do not understand. It establishes a reinforced, emotionally satisfying narrative. Magical thinking need not be accountable or rationally coherent. I am able to cross the political divide when the person I seek connection with has different opinions using facts, interpretations of the consequences of public policies, and reason. I get bogged down when I'm up against magical thinking. Magical thinking is fertile ground for accepting conspiracy theories. Magical thinking is a human thing. We all hold unsubstantiated beliefs. We are all looking for meaning, trying to make sense of the world around us. It's too easy to be drawn into conspiracy theories. For conspiracy theories provide a story explaining why people are suffering or why there is evil in the world. Conspiracy theories can connect us to something that feels meaningful and significant. They are a response to the loss of confidence in mainstream thinking, conventional ideas, accepted facts. Conspiracy theories open us up to fringe views. Conspiracy theories are not confined to the political right. I have liberal friends with whom I try to avoid any possibility of them bringing up the Kennedy assassination. It's too easy to see someone else's hard-held beliefs as fanciful and my own as real and justified. Social media is a means of drawing us into false beliefs. The COVID pandemic provides the perfect petri dish for growing and amplifying conspiracy theories, adding a dangerous, contagious plague to the existing fear mix, ratchets up the sense of danger and lack of control. I find it disturbingly ironic that the pandemic has made so many people hostile to simple safety precautions like wearing masks and social distancing. The COVID pandemic has pushed part of America's consciousness into an accompanied national outbreak of oppositional defiant disorder modeled by our former president. COVID-19 is seen by some as another conspiracy among many, a first step down the rabbit hole of conspiracy thinking. I have a family member who recently shared a barrage of false COVID-19 statistics, demonstrating that the whole thing was an exaggeration, death levels were not accurate, masks were unnecessary, and it is all part of a plot to isolate us, destroy the economy, defund the police, let Antifa run wild, and all with the goal of destroying America. Have any of you had similar exchanges with some of your family members? How did I handle this? I did not engage or contradict. Another family member took this on and got no reply. I am saddened and frustrated. I remain silent. I have a friend who announced on Facebook that she opposed vaccine passports because she should have the freedom of choice to be vaccinated or not without government interference, and passport requirements would lead to health discrimination. Vaccines infringed on her liberty, she added. Besides, everything happens for a reason, and death is not the end of existence. Many responses to her post provided facts about COVID vaccines and virus transmission. Her allusions to fatalism and eternal life were called out as spiritual bypassing. People talked past each other, and I felt exhausted. Thank you, I appreciate that. Some of you may have also encountered privilege masquerading as liberty. The extent of our obligations to others can be difficult to grasp. Facing COVID-19, COVID denial is difficult enough. I do not look forward to dealing with a family member with QAnon beliefs, the apex predator of conspiracy theories. Shannon Foley Martinez, a former white supremacist, explained the attraction of QAnon recently on MSNBC. She said, "With conspiracy theories such as QAnon, it's easy to get lost in the big picture, forgetting that each individual has a unique story to how they got there. We're drawn in. All along, they feel like they were doing the right thing, like all of us, the hero of their own narrative. They were saving the children, stopping the steal, preserving the carefully constructed distortion of reality that they came to adopt. Coming from a place of deep disempowerment, when you feel like you have found the true truth, the real facts that have hitherto been hidden from you, it is very alluring and seductive, and it feels a lot like empowerment to a lot of people." I'm beginning to understand what Shannon Foley Martinez is saying. Reed Berkowitz, an alternative reality game designer, provided another QAnon insight. He introduced the term apophenia, the tendency to perceive a connection or meaningful pattern between unrelated or random things, such as objects or ideas. He wrote that there is no reality here, no actual solution in the real world. Instead, QAnon is a breadcrumb trail away from reality, away from actual solutions, and towards a dangerous psychological rush. It works very well because when you figure it out yourself, you own it. You experience the thrill of discovery, the excitement of the rabbit hole, the acceptance of a community that loves and respects your views. QAnon is an alternative role-playing game wrapped up in a sophisticated propaganda marketing campaign. It is engineered to create an alternative reality where QAnoners think that they have discovered the hidden truth. Social science professor Karen Douglas wrote, "People are attracted to conspiracy theories when important psychological needs are not being met." She identified three such needs: the need for knowledge and certainty, the existential need to feel safe and secure when powerless or scared, and among those high in narcissism, the need to feel unique compared to others. Emotional and rational thought are intertwined. We respond to a scary and threatening world. We accept facts that support our belief systems. Contrary facts are rejected. We create a self-reinforcing narrative where we are responding to our anxieties. We see ourselves taking action to make the world right again. Succumbing to our fears opens us up to radicalization, to extreme othering, irrational beliefs, even violence. Conspiracy theories are not built to last. They are premised on predictions that never materialize. Any and all outlandish claims are accepted. Dissent is not tolerated. There is no objective reality, and everything is interpreted and reinterpreted again. This incoherent mess of nonsense does not go away on its own. Every event is seen through the lens of the conspiracy. This reminds me of a quote that Mark Twain probably never said. "It's easier to fool people than to convince them that they have been fooled." How can I even begin to deal with this? To connect with those hip deep in magical thinking. For help, I reach for my ethical culture core values. Ethical culture respects the worth and dignity of everyone. To live this out in my relations with others, I treat others as worthy individuals who deserve to be treated with the utmost respect. Respect for their unique personhood. Respect for their aspirations and ideas. I must be able to hold respect even while remaining in disagreement. This respect is grounded in a deep feeling of mutual human connection. Felix Adler, who founded Ethical Culture, said, "There is a spiritual power within us, namely a power which so unifies our lives with others that these others come to be regarded as other selves." What Adler found was an inviolable faith in the importance of each person, a faith in human worth. Elevating the idea of human worth causes me to treat others better. It improves my ability to connect and the quality of my relationships. In seeking connection, I find myself operating in today's environment of increasing entrenched polarization. Looking out from my position on the blue side of the political divide, on the other side, I see a range of beliefs from economic conservatism to accepting the big lie that the election was stolen, to COVID denial, to full-blown QAnon conspiracy beliefs. In positioning myself here apart from that other side, I also succumb to othering. I enjoy the late-night show's presentation of nightly political ridicule and humiliation. I laugh and occasionally feel smug and superior. I realize that this is self-serving and doesn't get me any closer to reconciliation, and yet I continue to watch. Othering narrows my circle of compassion and concern, and it compromises my faith in human worth. I struggle to maintain perspective, to recognize myself in those with whom I disagree. I have the same human fears and insecurities. Our human nature unites us. To connect with others across the political divide, I need to calm down and slow down. Engaging in a contest of facts is not productive. Challenging beliefs only causes people to double down and shut down. I cannot make progress through argument or persuasion. What can I do? Mick West, a conspiracy theory debunker, recommends three things. Stay connected. Cutting them off is one less lifeline back to reality. Share information they may be lacking. On things that they may be looking at, be curious. Ask questions about how these conspiratorial claims would work. Often, when they delve a bit deeper, they can see when something is not plausible. Be patient. Progress takes time. Be gentle, be kind, be neutral. Believers will benefit more from our interest than and our respect than our condemnation. Sometimes I employ a time limit on the exchange of views that I have with others on the other side. It might go something like this. I sense that there's something you really want to share with me, and I'm willing to hear what you have to say for 2 minutes. After that, I may take 2 minutes to reply or ask questions, or I may pass. Then I want to hear about your granddaughter. When having these conversations, I need to see those with opposing views as fellow flawed human beings that I can positively influence. I need to recognize our profound shared connection of human worth. I need to support those I care about and give them space to come to their own conclusions. Society does not encourage this approach. We all need a safe space to learn from our mistakes, to make room for changes in our thinking. We are not trained to live up to our mistakes publicly, to admit that we are wrong without feeling shame. We are not encouraged or practiced at using our mistakes productively. We need to be able to find the opportunities that our mistakes provide us. We need to work for change through patience, love, and connection, where the edges of my bubble touch those who are politically different. I will counter truth with hate and violence with human connection and love, sometimes tough love. I realize that this is a high bar and it may not work. For me, it is the right thing to do. This is what I aspire to do in my personal life, in my interactions with others. There is a difference between how I engage with individuals and my political engagement. The needed responses in my political life are much different. The world is indeed a scary place, especially when many on the right have lost their grip on reality. A majority of Republican legislatures voted to overturn the results of the Electoral College, even after the Capitol was stormed by a deranged insurrectionist mob. Whether true believers or craven political opportunists, most of these lawmakers will not repudiate conspiracy theorists. Instead, they welcome their support. There is a disingenuous false equivalency when the media or politicians engage in both-sidism, saying that there are wild ideas on both sides of the political divide. The wacky ideas ascribed to the blue side of the divide are things like providing everyone with health care or a living wage. Polarization is progressing on both political parties. Nonetheless, I recognize that there are real differences between me and those who propagate the big lie that there was widespread fraud comprising the 2020 election. Conservative writer Andy Craig from the Libertarian Cato Institute observed, "Democrats are not immune from polarizing radicalization. They are getting worse too. But they aren't sending mobs to storm the Capitol. Their base isn't entwined with something as bizarre and crazy as QAnon. They are still more or less normal politicians, if ones with terrible policy ideas. Something is different, and qualitatively so, about the GOP in the age of Trumpism." Even libertarians recognize that our politics is off the rails. Unlike my reserved attitude in my personal relations, I must stand up for truth when it comes to politics. I must stand up and oppose lies and distortions. I must confront those who promote untruths. I must hold people accountable. I need to call out politicians who refuse to acknowledge that the only reason that people distrust the presidential election results is the sustained campaign of lies that these politicians supported and propagated. A disinformation campaign that led to an angry mob of conspiracy theorists storming the Capitol in the hope of overturning a free and fair election. Voltaire once said, "Those who you can make believe absurdities, you can make commit atrocities." He was correct. Joe Biden said that those who participated in the January 6th insurrection at the Capitol do not reflect a true America and do not reflect who we are. Many commentators on the left have retorted, "Wrong, this is exactly who we are." Both of these positions engage in too much reductionism, glossing over the complex and multifaceted condition of contemporary politics and American society. We are more than just that, and that is who we are too. In so many ways, those who storm the Capitol are part of who we are, and I'm committed to trying to do something about it. Political polarization has made compromise questionable. It's hard to negotiate with politicians who will not publicly accept the results of the last election. Accountability is needed, lies must be retracted, apologies are needed to move forward. Without this, compromise becomes complicity. Apologies do not appear to be forthcoming. Biden's vision of a bipartisan Congress appears to be a dangerous fantasy. Polarization is too entrenched. It is time to exercise political will and political power. Sometimes turnabout is fair play. I will do this by working forward systemic political change for a society that benefits everyone, supporting activist interventions for social justice, endorsing direct relief for those who are suffering. As Christian Hayden said, pick places where you put your effort. If we put in the work, we can make it happen. If we keep putting in the work, it will get better. I am under no illusions. The struggle is real and ongoing. In the past, well-intentioned people have been drowned by waves of authoritarianism and fascism. I may end up on the losing side of the battle for the soul of our democracy. I will persevere, stick to my values, placing hope in the healing power of human connection, and in organizing and voting, and in protesting and contributing financially. I will also continue to struggle with the challenges across the political divide in my personal life. I will recognize myself in others, see our common human struggle to make sense of a dangerous world. I will see others as fallible human beings like I am. I will recognize the worth in those that I disagree with. Through maintaining connection, listening, being curious and asking questions, sharing information when I have the right opportunity, being patient, for change takes its own time. I will provide a safe space for people to examine and challenge their thinking. I will offer love and see what happens, for it is the right thing to do. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Randy. And we are going to do some Q&A. And so what I would say for most of us who are on Zoom, you can please feel free to put your question in the chat, or you can raise your hand. And you raise your hand by clicking on the reactions button at the bottom of your screen, that little smiley guy with the plus sign. If you click on that, you'll see the raise hand function. And if you don't see that in your version of Zoom, you can also use the chat. And I'm just scrolling through faces and looking for hands. And if you're not, if your video isn't on, but you use the raise hand function, we'll still see that, just an FYI. So you don't have to have your camera on to answer a question, or to ask a question, rather. While people are thinking of questions, I'll ask a question. And that for Randy, I watch a lot of CNN. That's my primary news source, I would say. I like Chris Cuomo, but I increasingly have kind of been somewhat frustrated with him, because I think that he's pretty one-sided oftentimes. And while his one-sidedness is usually aligned with what I think, I do feel like I'm not getting a very balanced dose of news by listening to him. I'm curious if you have any suggestions in terms of how we get our information, where should we be getting our information, considering the fact that so many news sources seem polarized themselves?
Okay, I don't suggest that you turn on Fox News to get the other side of the story. Mm-hmm. One thing that I do, and the two major newspapers that I follow are the Washington Post and the New York Times, and they do have conservative opinion writers. And I know who they are, and I actually force myself to read their opinion pieces, which often make me angry and frustrated. But I think that's a good source for me to see a more rational discourse on the other side, a critique of the ideas and policies that I support. And that has been useful for me to help maintain that type of bridge to the other side. But it is hard. Our views are very siloed, and it's so much easier to just go on autopilot and not click on those editorials that I know that I'm going to disagree with and are going to make me angry. But I think that the medicine is good, and I need to take it.
Yeah, I think that speaks to what you mentioned about the feedback loop, because the way the internet works, the more you click on things, the more it feeds you those things, whether it's a bidet or a particular article that has a leaning, then you just keep hearing the same information, which makes it much harder. Abe Markham, did you have a question you wanted to ask? I think I saw you raising your hands. And we just need you, Abe, to unmute first.
Hi, Randy. Randy, I think your solutions were brilliant, and I'll begin to try to use them in trying to make connections. But my question is, why are so many people susceptible to these conspiracies? What's happened in America that made people feel that they were alienated from progress that's being made in civil rights and so on?
Thank you, Abe, and it's good to hear from you. I think part of the problem is the change and some of the progress that's being made in society, and that we are having greater acceptance of diverse people, such as gay rights and, more importantly, trans rights. And we can see how that is disturbing to a lot of people in the legislation that we're seeing propagated in many states now, opposing trans rights and medical treatment for young trans people and things like that. And I think that civil rights is it too, that Black Lives Matter is that, you know, really the statement that Black Lives Matter too, damn it. And that idea has been threatening to a lot of people who see a very limited pie. And they think then that if they welcome other people in to have their share of the pie, there will be less for them. And that is really not the way to look at things, and it's not true. But the asserting the rights of all people is threatening to many people, because it can go against their conservative values that they may get reinforced through their religious organizations or through other aspects of society. And that makes them very disturbed, that they feel the world is crashing down on them, and that makes them susceptible to these weird views that complain that it's really all about a great conspiracy, from Hillary Clinton to Joe Biden to shipping children in wardrobes across the world, and that, you know, they're really just more bizarre and bizarre. And once you start going down that rabbit hole, and once you start discovering these facts that are the breadcrumbs that were laid there for you to find to put the puzzle together, you feel like you've really got it and you really understand it, and you don't know how divorced from reality you are, and that's what makes it hard to cross that divide.
Abe, thank you for the question. And there's a question that came up in the chat, which is, could you, Randy, could you say more about the merit or the danger of seeing or reading other points of view?
I'm sorry, I didn't quite hear all of that.
Sure. Could you say more about the merit or the danger of seeing or reading other points of view?
I don't really see a danger in exposing yourself to other views on the other side. I think it increases my understanding, and that is helpful to me. And it's also helpful to me to try to imagine these people as real people who are really trying to make sense of their world, and that they have cling to some false ideas, but that isn't necessarily something that is unchangeable. So I think it's very good to hear the distorted voices on the far end of the spectrum, just as I like to challenge myself on the left too, to hear ideas that are much farther out than those that I might be comfortable with, to see, well, what would a world look like that had that, that as a value and that as an opportunity, that had that available to everybody. I think that is the part of the difference is, one, I see as ideas that are opening and liberating, and another that ideas that are retrograde and deciding that trans people are illegitimate and need to be clamped down on in our laws.
Mm-hmm. I see a raised hand from Joan. Joan, I'm just going to ask you to unmute to ask your question.
Yes.
We can hear you, Joan.
Okay. Randy, I met you briefly at an AEU assembly about 10 years ago when I was working on creating the AEU songbook. And so I'm very happy to listen to you and your points of view. My question is, do you feel school systems are empowered enough to do the right thing in school classrooms? Now, I know school systems are among the most complicated systems that we have going in the country, and everybody, parents get alarmed and this and that. But I read in the New York Times today of a success story where reason is triumphing in California, and they did suspend a school teacher who participated on January 6th on the march against the Capitol. And I was filled with trepidation as I read this article because I didn't know how it would go. And I thought, gee, this is good. I know you're located in the triangle area of our societies. Do you find that school systems are overly conservative in your part of the country at this time?
Well, I am less concerned with the sort of any kind of ideological litmus test for teachers that we have. I would judge them by their actions in the classroom. And there are times when actions outside of the classroom are egregious enough that they are important as well. But I really think that what we're seeing, and another reason that so many people are open to fringe conspiracy theories, is that we didn't invest enough in our educational system in the past, and that we didn't try to encourage critical thinking. We had more rote memorization to pass the end of year exams and things like that that didn't really promote the individual's strengths. And so I think that what we have done is under-resourced our educational systems, and we really need to change that. We need to change that in a significant way, and we need to recognize that our children are our future and to invest in our future. I am concerned, though, I share your concern, Joan, when you see that there are teachers who were involved in the insurrectionist mob at the Capitol, and that there should be some consequences to that if they indeed broke the law. And while I wouldn't want a QAnon conspiracy person to be saying that in the classroom, I think if that is their personal beliefs and they can silo that well, that's all right. I know that in my education, in grade school and junior high, I had some extremely conservative teachers, and I seem to emerge unscathed from that process. So I think we shouldn't narrow who can be our educators to any one segment or political view, but we have to really look at people's behavior and their public behavior that can impinge on their ability to effectively be representatives in teaching our children.
Thanks, Joan, for the question. I think we're going to do two more, one from Zoom, and then we have a question from Ceremonial Hall. Why don't we go to Zoom first and to Ken Gans? And Ken, do you want to unmute to ask your question?
Yes, I liked your distinction between magical thinking and evidence-based thinking, and I think that's very a good way of approaching a person's like QAnons and other people that have these far out theories. I mean, they're engaged in magical thinking, and but I don't know if you could confront them with the fact that their beliefs are illusionary or delusionary. I remember the difficulties that Dawkins had, you know, with that question. And there's always been this argument in America between the creationists and the evolutionists. And there's still apparently a lot of creationists around, and they just don't swallow the evolutionary arguments, or they don't want to put the effort into you know, evidence-based thinking and checking the evidence and evaluating the evidence. And but I thought it was good that, you know, I see a lot of people that are engaged in magical thinking, and I say, oh yes, that's good. That's good. That's a good way of approaching it. Yeah. Yeah.
Ken, did you have a question for Randy?
Hey, that's a great question. I think that you're right that we can't really, and I tried to say that we really can't confront people with facts if they're really engaged in magical thinking, that really doesn't work. If we approach them instead with curiosity, asking questions about their beliefs when appropriate, and if it becomes appropriate, you could challenge them about something, but maybe not right away. But the main thing is to try to maintain a human connection with them, to let them know that you are still connected with them, even though you have a disparity in your worldview. And that I think that is the way to work, slowly to bring in connection, but also to realize that it won't work, that there are people who are dyed-in-the-wool creationists, as your example was. They are embedded in creationist communities, and they are really not susceptible to challenging their thoughts. I have a cousin on my wife's side who handed me a book disputing Darwin's theory of evolution, which trotted out the same old tired arguments that have been refuted again and again and again. And the problem is that we're not dealing with the same rules of discourse, that in traditional debate, if you bring up something and it is debunked, then that issue is dead. The next time you have the debate, you don't bring up that issue again and require the person to refute it again. It's just spinning your wheels and you're going nowhere. So I think there is always a good possibility that efforts to bridge the divide into magical thinking will not bear fruit and will not change anyone's mind. But I think there is value in maintaining human connection in any event.
Thank you. Just one last question, and this is from Scotty, who's in Ceremonial Hall. And the question is, do you think the sharp division of wealth impacts what's on the table? Do you think class may also be playing a role in our current politics and protests?
I think so, absolutely. Class is a subtext in America that is never talked about, that we are a society which is, the myth is that it's a meritocracy, that anyone can raise themselves up by their bootstraps and cross the divides of extreme wealth that separate the wealthiest Americans from the rest of us. And this is just not true. We've seen that the Republican tax cuts in the Trump administration continue to funnel the wealth up to the top 1% of the population. And that hasn't made the rest of us any better off. Class is something that is a difficult subject to broach. Whenever it's brought up, you're in accused of engaging in class warfare, and that's supposed to be a bad thing, that we're just supposed to let the richest Americans who don't really give a toss about the rest of us, we're supposed to leave them alone, so they can be comfortable and not have to face their complicit participation in an unfair economic system that has given them so much and taken so much from so many others. And I think that's something that has to be addressed. I like the ideas of taxing the most wealthy to pay for programs for the rest of us. And if they're carping about it, how many millions do you need to swim into to be comfortable? I'm not quite Huey Long on this, but I think that we could have a restoration of a progressive tax structure in America, and we would be better off for it.
Well, thank you very much, Randy, for being here.
Good job of mediating the hybrid format that we have today.
Yeah, it's been great. It's great to have you. Great to see you in the space. And we appreciate you being here with us this morning. Great to see you. And thank you so much for your remarks and for taking some questions. You know, put you on the spot for that. So thank you.